Good evening, Doctor. I, Shuman, on behalf of Shield Healthcare, welcoming you all in today's webinar. And the topic of the today's webinar is role of vaginal probiotics in infertility management. And our guest speaker is Dr. M. Lavanya, madam. Before moving into the webinar, let's have a look on our Shield Connect page. This is our Shield Connect page. Here you can find.
Shuman, on behalf of Shield Healthcare, welcoming you all in today's webinar. And the topic of the today's webinar is role of vaginal probiotics.
Please mute.
And our guest speaker is Dr. M. Lavanya.
Someone, please mute.
Before moving into the webinar, let's have a look on.
Please mute.
Suman Shah, please mute.
So this is my blog. This is different blogs written by many eminent doctors in that platform. And these are the past webinars already we have conducted in our platform. And this is the PCOS awareness blog. Here you can find many talks related to the PCOS by many eminent doctors as well. And these are the most important blogs in this COVID era time, that is COVID-19 coronavirus awareness blog. Here you can find different blogs related to the coronavirus, and you can see that myo-inositol or curcumin, which have an effect in the treatment of the coronavirus as well. And the most important thing is our key opinion leaders. Almost 250 to 300 doctors are currently supporting us this knowledge sharing platform, that is Shield Connect. And I request all the participants, please have a look on this website. It is a very much important and informative page. And now it's time to start our webinar, and it's my honor to introduce Madam. Madam is the obstetrics and gynecologist and fertility specialist and IVF consultant. Madam has 10 years of experience in obstetrics and gynecology, practicing assisted reproductive technology. Madam MBBS. I did an MBBS under NTR UHS and completed a DGO and trained ART from IIRFT, IFC, New Delhi. Madam has a diploma in reproductive medicine from Kiel University, Germany, and a certified member of maternal thyroid disorders management program in Thyroid Society. And Madam is presently acting as a clinical director at Sri Affordable Fertility Center, Secunderabad. So with this short introduction, I request Madam, please take over the session. And meanwhile, I request all the participants for their active participation. And please post your queries on the QA dashboard of the Shield Connect page. So once it will be over, we can have a short discussion with this topic with Madam. So thank you, ma'am, and over to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, Suman. Thank you for the introduction. Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am. You can share your screen. It's perfect, madam. You can start.
Yeah, can I start, Suman?
Yes, ma'am. You can start.
Yes. Hi, everyone. A warm welcome and good evening to all of you. I sincerely thank all the team members of Shield Connect for this opportunity of presenting the webinar. And I welcome all the doctors for today's webinar. And my topic for today is the vaginal probiotics and its role in the infertility management. So coming back to the main here, the human commensal microbiome, it is referred to as the other human genome, and it is evolved with the human genome to help maintain the human health. These microbial dysbiogenesis and invasion of pathogens, it can lead to disease and even threaten the human life. The vaginal microbiota, it plays an important role in maintaining these physiological homeostasis of the vaginal environment and protects the colonization of colonization by these opportunistic pathogens. The various diversity of these microflora, which are present in the female reproductive tract, is affected by the drugs as well as the environmental changes and the host hormonal levels and immune system. Way back to the history, actually the concept of probiotics was first introduced in as early as 20th century by then the Nobel Prize winner by Eli Metchnikoff. Actually, he suggested the long life, the healthy lifespan of the Bulgarian peasants, the farmers, who resulted from their consumption of these. They used to take the milk products, which are actually the fermented. And they have seen that a special change in the longevity, the lifespan of these farmers are increased. So that he then experimented and introduced himself in his diet, the sour milk, the fermented milk with this bacteria. And he named this bacteria as Bulgarian bacillus. And later the term was coined as Lactobacillus delbrueckii. These are the subspecies variety and which are found in this health benefited. He proposed that the consumption of these fermented food products, they positively influenced the microflora of the gut intestine, the GIT tract, the colon, and it decreases the toxic microbacterial activity. Also, it decreases the intestinal pH, making it more acidic and suppressing the growth of this proteolytic bacteria. The root word of probiotic comes from the Greek word, the pro, meaning promoting, and the biotic meaning the life. So it promotes the basic life. The Food and Agricultural Organization of United Nations, the FAO, it defines the probiotics as the live microorganisms, which when they are administered in adequate amount, they produce the beneficial effect to the host when taken orally. And there are so many list of probiotics, like in microorganisms, they have bacteria, fungi, and the yeast. In bacteria, there are different genera, namely the lactobacilli, bifidobacterium, streptococcus, bacillus, pediococcus, leuconostic. And there are different subspecies in each genera. When coming to the fungi, these are the Aspergillus, Aspergillus niger, and Aspergillus oryzae. And in yeast, it is Saccharomyces, Boldreddi, Cerevisiae, and etc. These are only academic interest. Now coming to the main microorganisms which are present in the vagina, the lower female reproductive system and upper female reproductive system, which includes the ovaries, the fallopian tubes, and the uterus. In vagina, the whole length of around 10 centimeters, here the pH is maintained in acidic. So it is around 4.7. And as you ascend over the reproductive tract, in cervix, the pH is maintained at around 7 alkaline. And the upper part of the uterus, the fallopian tubes and ovaries here, the pH is maintained in the alkaline. So there are normally good microbial flora, which are the lactobacilli, which are present. Also the other bacteroids like firmicutes, bacteroidetes, proteobacteria, actinobacteria are also present in different parts of the female reproductive system. So the most common organisms which are present in the age group, like in childhood, these are the E. coli and the anaerobes. Anaerobes are the predominant organisms in childhood. And the lactobacillus colonization, it begins in the pubertal age, and this decreases after the menopause. So the age-related composition of the presence of these lactobacillus indirectly shows that it is predominantly estrogen-dependent. So in puberty till menopause, the level of estrogens are more in the female. So this imbibes a lot of lactobacilli organisms, and these are very protective to the female. So what are the properties of probiotics? Actually, any probiotic, if you take, it should be very safe to the host, and it should not produce any pathogenic or toxic effects on the body. And it should be definitely resistant to the hydrochloric acid, the bile juices, and the pancreatic juices. Because if they are digestible, then they do not act on the lower GIT tract. Though it should have a good action on the colon, and it should colonize the bacteria inside the GIT. And it should have the anti-carcinogenic activity also. It should be able to produce a lactic acid. And this is a reason that the pH should be maintained. pH is very less, acidic pH. And a good probiotic should also retain the viability during the storage and the usage. And it should definitely stimulate the immune system of the body. It should be able to colonize the GIT tract. So what is the main mechanism? How do these probiotics work? So actually these probiotics, they interfere with the treatment and prevention of the intestinal digestion. They contribute to the improvement of the immune system thereby, and they reduce the risk of cholesterol levels. They also produce the different microbial substances, thereby avoiding the pathogenic organisms. They also interfere in the cancer process, and thereby they prevent the process of or growth of the cancer cells. They have the favorable effect even in the liver illness, and they should able to prevent any allergy related to the GIT system, and they should able to deliver the vitamins for the organisms, and they should able to synthesize the different vitamins like thiamine, riboflavin, and pyridoxin. So the mechanism here is there is a lot of competition for the adhesion of the receptors and sites. The presence of these bacteria in the intestinal tract, they are dependent on their ability to get attached to the gut epithelial cells. So in such a way that they become immobilized of the gut wall, and they resist being flushed out either by the movements of the intestine as well as any occupying a nick at the expense of potentially harmful organisms. Though they should able to sustain the movement of the GIT system. And also they should produce the immunity response. So here the underlying mechanisms of immune stimulation is specifically by the cell wall components and the cell layers, and thereby they act as adjuvant and increase the both T cell and B cell humoral immune responses. And thereby they should able to degrade the number of toxic receptors. So coming to the vaginal ecosystem, a good vaginal homeostasis is maintained by a balance of both the harmful bacteria and the good bacteria. A healthy vaginal ecosystem, the dynamic equilibrium is definitely existing between the normal vaginal epithelium, the normal colonizing organisms, which are predominantly the lactobacilli and different subspecies, the local secretory and cellular immune factors. The vaginal pH is also maintained with acidic, and it creates an unfavorable environment for the pathogen organisms. So the predominantly, as I said to you, the normal vaginal flora is occupied by the lactobacilli. These are actually the gram-positive rods, and they excrete hydrogen peroxide. They're present in almost 100% of women with healthy normal flora. And these lactobacilli, they adhere to the epithelial cells, and thereby they act as soldiers. So they protect their territory and against these disease-causing organisms from the bacteria and other yeast infections. So these other facultative organisms do are present in the vaginal ecosystem, and these are the diphtheroids, coagulase negative staphylococci, streptococci, E. coli, Ureoplasma urolyticum, Mycoplasma hominis. So other anaerobic organisms which are present in very low concentrations yet and they are non-pathogenic. These are the Peptostreptococcus, bacteroids, Fusobacterium, Mobilincus, Gardnerella. Among them, like Gardnerella are present in almost 40 to 60% of normal vaginal secretions. When the system between, or when the balance between these pathogenic organisms and lactobacillus, they occur, then there will be occurrence of these vaginal infections. So this is an important slide. So in a nutshell, it will show the composition of this vaginal microbiome. So there are community subtypes like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 types are there, and according to the species specific. So community CST type 1 is Lactobacillus cryptases, Lactobacillus crispatus, and in type 2 is Gasseri. The species in type 3 is Inners, and CST 4 is devoid of the Lactobacillus species, and CST5 contains this Gensemi. Here in the whole of the vagina, the predominantly the Lactobacillus are present. The most, more than 70% of vaginal flora is maintained by this Lactobacilli. Rest others are the Firmicutes, bacteroids, Actinobacteria, Proteobacteria, Staphylococcus, and Streptococcus. So this is also one of the interesting slide. It shows the type of vaginal flora which is present in normal healthy vaginal mucosa, and this is dependent on the age, and indirectly this is dependent on the estrogen levels. So initially in infants up to 6 weeks of age, the vaginal pH is maintained at an acidic pH, And here the predominantly they are the lactobacilli and other less common streptococci, enterobacteriaceae, streptococcus epidermidis and enterococci are present. Whereas coming to the in the pre-puberty stage, where the estrogen levels are very less and the pH is maintained in neutral, and other organisms like ureoplasma, gardenella, mycoplasma are present. When coming back to the puberty, when the initial spurt of estrogen levels are increasing, again the pH comes back to acidic pH and it is very protective to the pathogenic organisms. So there are more number of lactobacilli here. And along with other pathogenic organisms like streptococci, enterobacteriaceae, and other rest, the above said organisms. While coming to the menopause, as the level of estrogen decreases again, it comes back to the neutral pH. And again, the risk of the vaginal infections increase because of this gardenella, ureoplasma, mycoplasma, candida, and mobilicus, and other pathogenic bacteria. So definitely the normal vaginal flora do have a protective role in the host immune system. So this is actually the mechanism here. Coming from inner to the outside, this is a vaginal lumen and this is a vaginal mucosa. And these are the different layers of the vagina here. Here in the walls of the vagina, we can see so many cells, which are the dendritic cells, macrophages, T lymphocytes, Langerhans cells, which all improve the immune response. And with the presence of these estrogen levels, these cells get activated and they produce glycogen. And this glycogen is taken up by the lactobacilli and this will convert into the lactic acid. And they also secrete the hydrogen peroxide. So increase estrogen and they cause to increase epithelial glycogen, and the lactobacilli, they convert this glycogen into lactic acid, making the vaginal pH more acidic. And this acidic pH is very good for maintaining the vaginal immunity. And abnormal pH, any increase in the pH like alkaline, this is caused by these aggravating factors like any trauma to the vagina or low estrogen levels, pre-puberty or post-menopausal and during the time of menstrual flow or menses and alkaline seminal fluid. So this imbalance will alter the vaginal ecosystem and this will disrupt the epithelial cells and it causes the desquamation, infection, inflammation, also any risk of carcinoma in the vagina also, or in fact any reproductive tract. So coming to the urinary tract infections in women, it is one of the most common, especially in the sexually active women and in the reproductive age group. So almost all like 1 billion each year are suffering from the urinary tract infections. Most of them are asymptomatic, but more serious infections come from the symptomatic infections. And more than 300 million cases, they are annually worldwide. Each episode almost lasts for a week on an average of 5 to 7 days. That is the duration of the symptoms. And the sequelae for this UTI is a pyelonephritis. And in pregnancy, it may also cause, it may lead to the preterm birth or PPRM, preterm premature rupture of membranes, and also a grievous chorioamnioitis also. The uropathogens, which are mostly commonly caused by this E. coli, and approximately 70% of the organisms, they cause these urinary tract infections. Other more common organisms like Enterobacteriaceae, Enterococcus faecalis, and Staphylococcus species. So increasing drug response among the uropathogens. Coming to the female genitourinary tract infections, these genitourinary tract infections come when the normal vaginal flora is disturbed. That is the urinary tract infections because of this E. coli, gram-negative Staphylococcus aureus. And the other main important vaginal infection is the bacterial vaginosis. This is actually the vaginosis is a condition. It is not the vaginitis. So it is a lactobacilli deficiency syndrome. So actually there is no infection seen here, but it mimics the inflammation kind of thing. The main causative organism here is the Gardnerella vaginalis. And other common causes also caused by this Atopobium vaginae, which are the anaerobes, Mycoplasma hominis, Ureoplasma urealyticum, and the candid infections like candid albicans. So these are different subspecies of lactobacillus. So the right bacilli, these are the normal residing bacteria. So identification of cultured vaginal lactobacilli, practically it's not that possible, but time consuming and it is also costly affair, but it can be done in highly resistant cases using the tDNA polymerase chain reaction. So what are the main factors which modify the vaginal microbiota? So as I said you earlier, these are the factors which influence this vaginal microbiota. These are mainly the age-related factors, like in different age groups of women and during the pregnancy, and any vaginal infections and other conditions like ethnic group, smoking and cancer. Coming to the age-related, as I said earlier, the childhood, the low estrogen levels and the glycogen levels, they produce less lactobacilli, and this will cause the alkaline pH and thin vaginal epithelium also. Coming to the adult women, because of the high estrogen levels and the glycogen, it produces the acidic pH and the high lactobacillus species, and this will also cause a good vaginal epithelium layers. And again, in postmenopause, the lower estrogen and high pH, it will disturb the vaginal epithelium. Coming in the pregnant states, like in a lower concentration of mycoplasma and ureaplasma, these are present, and the decrement is in the pH and increment in the vaginal secretions. And the other factors, which are the infections, also cause modify the vaginal microbiota. Infections, like the main causative here is the bacterial vaginosis. So here the lactobacillary microflora is disturbed and they are decreased in numbers. And the pH is alkaline, more than 4.5. Here the typical clinical feature, bacterial vaginosis can be diagnosed in the OP basis by simple perspiculum clinical examination. There is thick, copious, whitish gray discharge. Often it is false smelling, and on inspection, we can see the inflammatory changes. The Gardnerella vaginalis is the main causative organism, and less likely are also mobilincus. So aerobic vaginitis, which are the lactobacillary microflora, this is disturbed here. The pH is alkaline. In this infection, in the aerobes infection, the discharge mostly is of yellowish color, and Staphylococcus aureus and E. coli are the predominant organisms. So though these are the less likely other main factors which modify the vaginal microbiota, like race, ethnicity, the location-wise, the difference in the changes in the pH, the local environmental factors also play a key role in modifying the vaginal microbiota, depending on the ethnic group. And also coming to the smoking. So there are different pilot studies. Here we have seen that the females who are smokers, their vaginal secretions and body, the bodily fluids, they produced very low levels of estrogen. And this also, in smokers, we could able to see the presence of BPDE, which is a benzopyrene diol epoxide. It is a substance which causes the vaginal, which are present in the vaginal secretions, and they cause the phage induction. And this will indirectly decrease the quantity of the lactobacillus. So BPDE indirectly decrease the lactobacillus population, and thereby increasing the alkaline pH, causing more than 4.5 and inviting the vaginal pathogenicity. So also the cancer here, also in cancer states, because of the increased vaginal pathogenic organisms, there is risk of HPV infection, HIV infection, or simple herpes. And here also the lactobacilli population is decreased, imbibing the vaginal pathogens. So bacterial vaginosis is the most common vaginal infection, especially it is seen in the women of childbearing age and sexually active women. It is also associated with severe critical health issues, and it may also lead to preterm birth, poorer pregnancy outcomes, any first trimester or second trimester miscarriages also. Women in their reproductive age are at higher risk of getting infected with bacterial vaginosis, and this is mostly due to practicing unprotected intercourse and douching, severe douching, and having multiple sexual partners and harmful lifestyle factors, which includes the smoking also. So bacterial vaginosis mainly occurs at higher vaginal pH of more than 4.5 with more alkaline vaginal conditions and due to numerous colonies of anaerobic bacteria in the vagina than the lactobacilli, and which is frequently reported to postmenopausal women. So what are the risk factors, especially for the bacterial vaginosis? Here, the pregnancy and immediate postpartum period and during the menstruation, sexual activity, excessive vaginal washing, antibiotic exposure, any local or systemic infections in the female, all this will disturb the bacterial flora. Healthy microbiota with lactobacilli, gram-positive cocci, bacteriophages, and yeast, this will maintain the normal vaginal flora. And in this dysbiosis, when these levels are disrupted, other species of lactobacillus and gram-positive anaerobic cocci, eukaryotic viruses, gram-negative bacilli, all this will, these are the risk factors for the bacterial vaginosis. So they increase the likelihood of bacterial vaginosis with a history of multiple sexual partners or sexual relationship with a new partner, and excessive cigarette smoking, excessive vaginal douching, and the use of IUDs. Although most of these risk factors are related to sexual activity, also few women who have never had vaginal intercourse also do develop bacterial vaginosis. So what are the sequelae or the after effects of bacterial vaginosis and urinary tract infection? So there is risk of carcinogenic activity, because of the increased herpes simplex virus type 2 infection and increased HIV shedding, and there is vertical transmission of this HIV infection from mother to the child, and increased HIV transmission, susceptibility to HIV infection. So infection with chlamydia trachomatis and HPV also. All this cause an increase in the early pregnancy loss even after IVF conception. So associated with the recurrent early pregnancy losses, it is also associated with the recurrent PIDs and postpartum endometritis. So here in this graph, in the horizontal axis, it is the increase in the pH. So here it is the acidic and here it is the alkaline pH. As the number of germs are increasing, the normal flora, the lactobacilli, they keep decreasing, and this is because of the alkaline pH. And from the acidic, in acidic environment, the Gardnerella, Vaginalis, anaerobes are inactive. So as the vaginal pH is changed, this will increase in the population, and they cause these symptoms and different vaginal infections like bacterial vaginosis. So cytolytic vaginosis is also one condition, also known as dodelin cytolysis. It is exactly opposite. It is because of the lactobacillus overgrowth syndrome. And this increase in the population of lactobacilli, they cause the lysis of the vaginal epithelial cells. And this results in itching, vulval irritation, pruritus, burning or inflammation, and painful vulvodyna or dysuria, and painful intercourse also. The patients suffering from diabetes mellitus, poorly controlled diabetic mellitic patients are more susceptible to these kind of infections. So vulvovaginal candidiasis is also one of the most common. Every one or two patients in every gynec OPD, we can see these candid infections. But in contrast to bacterial vaginosis, this candidiasis infection mainly affects the premenopausal women who are having low vaginal pH, that is the acidic pH, and generally observed in non-pregnant women, resulting in mild to moderate infections, though the history of sexual contact may not be there. But the self-hygiene or any abnormal sugar levels in the body, poorly controlled diabetes, these are all the risk factors for the candida infections. And females in their childbearing age, any exogenous estrogen using the postmenopausal females or any immunocompromised females are at higher risk of acquiring the complicated vulvovaginal candidiasis. So these are grossly the three different types which we see very commonly in the OPD. So the first is the bacterial vaginosis. Here there is a fishy order discharge, is there thick purulent discharge. The first, we should have the diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis. Simple speculum examination is more than enough. No need of testing in the potassium hydroxide wet mount test or NaCl, saline, simple saline test also. And in candidiasis, thick cottage cheese appearance can be seen in the vaginal walls. If you are able to remove the tissue, even the vaginal epithelium may bleed sometimes. And in trichomonas infections, there is yellowish green gray discharge. So after completing the different vaginal infections, coming to the role of prebiotic in the pregnancy. So do we have to give the prebiotics in pregnancy? That is one of the important topic here. The probiotics and prebiotics both are from the natural food sources and supplements are considered. Here it is very safe even for the healthy pregnant women. A very common side effect in pregnant women is constipation, and this can be cured by this probiotic supplement. So pro and prebiotics can help in increasing the immune system of the baby even during the pregnancy. Any abnormal vaginal microbiota is definitely associated with the tubal fertility, tubal factor infertility, and early spontaneous abortions in IVF patients, in vitro fertilization patients. And since this vaginal microbiota continuum exists along the whole of the female reproductive tract, both in the lower and the upper, and it is also associated with pregnancy-related diseases, sexually transmitted diseases, infertility-related metabolic diseases, and gynecological tumors. Microbiota and its metabolites, they might associate with every step in the IVF, right from the pickup of the oocytes, including the gamete formation, implantation, and delivery. Even the IVF is successful, they may result into early pregnancy loss or in the recurrent early pregnancy loss, though it is all other causes are ruled out. So in vitro fertilization and embryo transfer is now widely applied in treating infertility. So as the number of IVF cycles continues to increase, there are all, the recurrent implantation failure also comes as a big challenge to the clinician. So the cause of recurrent implantation failure is very complex and it's very wide and it remains largely unrevealed. So especially for those without any pathological features. So this vaginal microbiota is associated with many female reproductive diseases such as pregnancy-related diseases, STDs, tubal factor infertility, and first trimester miscarriages after IVF. So here are two types of these classification for vaginal microbiota. CST, the community state types are 1, 2, 3, 4 is divided into A and B and fifth one. So these are mainly classified on the basis of subspecies. So Lactobacillus crispatus, these are present more in the first type, cervical type 1 and CST type 1. So Lactobacillus gesseri, it belongs to CST type 2. Lactobacillus inners dominate, it is belongs to 2 in cervical types and 3 in CST types. So in that way, the fourth A and B is actually not related to this Lactobacillus. It is Gardnerella vaginalis dominated, and there is high diversity of the vaginal microflora, both the facultative and anaerobic bacteria. So what does the ethnicity do with the vaginal microbial composition? Here, there are different subgroups all over the world. Here, the total population here we can see. Definitely, the vaginal microbiota groups in different ethnic groups, the levels of these are different. And so is the occurrence of the vaginal infections. So what are the factors, coming to the factors influencing the vaginal microbiota? So the endogenous factors play a vital role. The vaginal epithelial structures as well as the microbiota, they change considerably from childhood to the menopause. And during menstruation, the non-lactobacillus species, they appear to increase in number, while the lactobacillus decrease or they stay approximately the same number. During the pregnancy, the lactobacillus dominant microbiota is strengthened by the increased estrogen levels. However, at the same time, the incidence of these candidial infections increases when compared with non-pregnant women. During the time of menopause, the prevalence of lactobacillus is decreased because of the lesser estrogen levels and the vaginal pH is increased. So by this, estrogen has important and decisive effect on the composition of the lower genital tract microbiota. And what are the diagnostic criteria here? to diagnose a bacterial vaginosis. I think the slide has come to the last. And here there are two main criteria here, which is an undergraduate important question. We have this AMSL criteria way back from 1983. We are following this one. And another is the Nugent scoring system. So in AMSL criteria, there are mainly these factors like the discharge, the thin grayish white homogeneous discharge and alkaline pH and the with the 10% potassium hydroxide addition, the vaginal discharge, it produces the fishy odor and the presence of typical clue cells, which is a determinant factor with wet mount microscopy. These are the criteria for this bacterial vaginosis. Whereas the other method, that is a Nugent scoring system, the bacterial strains are assessed by gram staining. So these are divided in the presence of whether it is gram positive, large or small gram variable rods or variable coccobacilli or disappearance of lactobacilli species. Other rarely used methods are the rapid nucleic acid hybridization test, proline aminopeptidase activity, PCR polymerase chain reaction, sensor array, combinations of microbial products. But routinely, we need not use all these unless it is a very resistant vaginal infections, which are not able to treat with regular medication. So what are the limitations of this AMSL criteria? The potassium, with the addition of potassium hydroxide, the vaginal discharge produces fishy odor. But even the presence of semen may result in positive KOH. So it has the limitation here. And during douching, pre and post menstrual cycle, and even intercourse, vaginal secretions, they behave as bacterial vaginosis discharge. Even the candida infections, yeast infections, or trichomoniasis secretions may also give the same appearance as bacterial vaginosis. And the presence of clue cells also may be because of the degenerative cells or the debris. So what are the consequences of this vaginosis? An increased susceptibility to the sexually transmitted diseases, and including the HPV virus, human papilloma, or HIV virus. And this may lead to preterm labor or infertility. In IVF cases, failure of embryo implantation or recurrent early pregnancy loss or recurrent implantation failure and the carcinogenic risk. So evidence from several studies of differential vaginal microbiota composition in infertile patients when compared to healthy and fertile women. Abnormal vaginal microbiota has been associated with the poor reproductive outcome in patients who are undergoing IVF treatment as well as with early spontaneous abortions in patients who are undergoing IVF treatment. So recent research has identified a specific bacterial microbiome in the vagina, even in the endometrium and in the follicular fluid, in which we could able to see the presence of lactobacillus species, and it is seemed to be associated with the respectively outcome IVF outcome, pregnancy loss, and it also affects the quality of the embryo. So the presence of other specific microbes besides the lactobacillus, it is also associated with implantation failures or abortion rates. And it also harbors a specific microbiome existing of mainly anaerobic bacteria, including the lactobacillus. During spontaneous conception, this microbial content of even in the sperm, which are present in the seminal fluid, might enter the uterine cavity, and most likely they interact with the endometrial environment, including the local microbiota. The effect of presence of this lactobacilli within the local microbial community could be explained by its antimicrobial characteristics, such as its ability to produce the lactic acid. So what is the main property of lactic acid? It lowers the pH of the local environment because of its acidic nature and providing protection against invading pathogens. This lactic acid also prevents the vertical transmission by affecting the integrity of the cervical plug. Lactobacilli also produce the bacteriocins. These are the substances which have the potential to inhibit the bacterial growth and they physically prevent the other bacteria from binding to the epithelial surface. So there are different species of lactobacilli and they have different immunological properties too. So lactobacilli crispatus, it plays a role in protection against pathogens. The presence of lactobacillus inners, it can cause altered gene expression. Even there is a role of genetic here. So they cause the gene expression and different gene expression, including the defense against the bacteriophages, and is associated with the presence of bacterial vaginosis. the rapidly dividing blastocyst, it depends heavily on aerobic glycolysis. So, which is characterized by the presence of lactic acid. So the high level of aerobic glycolysis, it has been explained as energy provision for the energy consuming dividing blastocyst. And it also provides components necessary for the cellular membranes, nucleotides, and antioxidation. So it is during the implantation of the embryo, the levels of available oxygen are extremely low. And this causes the embryonic consumption of glucose. Increases. This increases the embryonic consumption of the glucose, and with it, because of this, more level of lactic acid is produced. So the resulting excessive lactic acid rich microenvironment of blastocyst is supposed to enable the local endometrium breakdown. So the endometrium and embryo dialogue is maintained. During this time, there is a this facilitates the invasion of the embryo into the endometrium, and it will modulate the local immune response, and in this way, the rejection of the semi-allogenic embryo is prevented. The beneficial effect of the presence of lactobacillus in the community on the reproductive outcome could be explained by several mechanisms, of which the production of lactic acid is probably the most important. Additional production of lactic acid by the local diversity of the lactobacilli, it could support the receptivity and support the invasion and acceptance of the hatching and developing blastocyst. Bacteriophages are different. They are the viruses that can infect the bacteria, and they interfere with their metabolism. They kill the infected microbes and allow for the horizontal gene transfer, hereby actively influencing the bacterial composition of the local vaginal microbiota. And there are several mechanisms describing the bacteriophage-driven dysbiosis which have been postulated. And either killing commensal bacteria by lactic infection, using internalized phages by killing competing bacteria, and integration of phage DNA into the bacterial genome to enhance the bacterial function. So this bacterial biomass, it seems to decrease from the vagina to the endometrium, whereas in the peritoneal fluid, it contains similar bacterial biomass as endometrial samples. There are so many studies which show that analysis of these vagino-uterine microbial profiles sampled prior to the laparoscopy, they allowed identification of women suffering from either uterine fibroids, endometriosis, or adenomyosis. So also there are so many pilot studies made on this cervicovaginal microbiome. So in a nutshell, these are the different cervicovaginal studies, Corridor, Liu, Brown, and SQ. They have made different scientific publications of these microbiomes, which are the parts of the female reproductive system. Even there are studies on the endometrium, and they have taken tissue from transcervical endometrial tissue, also the mid-endometrial tissue after the hysterectomy. And they have taken the simple low and high vaginal swabs. So even studies on the fallopian tubes after the post-hysterectomy or salpingectomy or oophorectomy, and vaginal swabs and even cervical swabs also shown the similar vaginal microbiota. So here is one prospective observational study which is showing the differential composition of vaginal microbiome, but not the microbiome, and it is associated with successful intrauterine insemination in couples with idiopathic infertility. So the importance of microbiome in reproduction, it extends beyond the embryo implantation phase and it impacts the health of the developing pregnancy. So it is known that the dysbiosis in obstetrics is linked to inflammatory states that result in spontaneous preterm birth and other adverse obstetric outcomes. In fertility treatment, the goal is healthy, full-term live birth. The role of microbiome and its alteration in the pre-implantation and peri-implantation phase may have such more implications. The vaginal microbiota and its relation to IVF outcomes, the altered vaginal mucosa microbiota and bacterial vaginosis may be related with poor pregnancy outcomes. This we have seen. So in community subtypes, 4 is the most associated with negative ART outcomes. So as already said you, the 4A and B are lactobacillus not predominant. So other pathogenic organisms will be there. Bacterial vaginosis or a perturbed microbiota are also a common factor in frequent preterm delivery or miscarriage, according to the study conducted by Bogo and Garcia Velasco. The CST type 4 with or without a diagnosed bacterial vaginosis has been described as a common feature of preterm birth in Caucasian women and African American women. So the endometrial microbiota also related to its relation to IVF outcome. Any dysbiosis or change in the microflora in the endometrium, it may cause the implantation failure as study conducted by Moreno and Simon in the year 2018. A lactobacillus dominant endometrium, it is more receptive than the endometrium with high bacterial diversity. So lactobacillus indirectly aids the positive outcome of IVF treatment. And the results of the study made by Moreno et al. In the year 2016, it highlights the women with the lactobacillus dominant microbiota and they have a higher successive pregnancy rate. Hormonal fluctuations, especially in the levels of estrogens, there are also implicated in the regulation of vaginal microbiota and in the preparation of the endometrium for implantation and pregnancy. It can be expected that hormones also influence the endometrial microbiota. So its relation to the preterm birth is also important, and it is important for the health of the whole reproductive tract and for the prevention of pathological infections. The vaginal microbiome, it evolves during the pregnancy in relation to the gestational age, and it tends to lose the diversity observed in non-pregnant women. A non-lactobacillus dominant vaginal microbiota and increased bacterial diversity during pregnancy are associated with increased risk of preterm births, as study conducted by Brown et al. In 2019. So there is also this one journal which is published in the Journal of Translational Medicine. It's a research paper. It shows a recurrent early pregnancy loss which is associated with the leaky gut. So any infections in the GIT also, so people who are having recurrent GI infections or chronic irritable bowel syndrome or any conditions where there is a GI tract infections, there we could see the women are suffering from recurrent early pregnancy loss. So it is one of the new pathogenic model for this endometrium inflammation. So in women with recurrent early pregnancy loss, the leaky gut might occur and they allow the passage of this passage into the circulation of immune triggers, and they potentially able to elicit the endometrial innate response, immune response, and this will contribute to the miscarriage and the pathogenesis. So there are different supporting studies which show that even the vaginal microbiota or the microbial flora which are present in the GIT also affects the reproductive rate even in the IVF. So there is here in conclusion, the present study defined a structural imbalance in the vaginal microbiota of patients with recurrent miscarriages, represented in an increased incidence of atopobium, prevotella, and streptococcus, and reduction of lactobacillus, which was identified by comparing the vaginal microbiota composition of recurrent miscarriages patients with that of healthy individuals. And PCO analysis suggested that changes in the vaginal flora may be the cause of associated with this RM. So coming to the treatment part, generally the main treatment guidelines for the bacterial vaginosis is we regularly give the metronidazole. Actually, we give 400 milligrams thrice daily for 1 week. This is a regular therapy we give. But only thing is the patient intolerance. If the patient is not able to tolerate, we can give antiemetic. There are also metronidazole 0.75% gels. It is available in single applicator, 5 grams intravaginally, once a day for 5 to 7 days. There is also clindamycin, even in the cream forms. Other alternative and patient-friendly treatment is the tinidazole. But only thing is that its role in pregnant women is not confirmed. So in tinidazole, the 2 grams orally once a day for 2 days can be given, and even 1 gram orally once a day for 5 days. So these guidelines are from the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. So in recommended regimens in pregnant patients, the recommended regimens are like metronidazole 2 grams per oral single stat. Next, if metronidazole allergy is rare, but no other drug classes available to treat the trichomonas, so a patient would need to see an allergist to get desensitized. Tinidazole is longer acting and is now generic, lost its patent, and it is cost competitive. Data from studies regarding the use of tinidazole in pregnancy are limited in human subjects. So the drug of choice as of now is the metronidazole. So how do you screen and treat the asymptomatic patients? So screening is generally not recommended in asymptomatic patients. A sexual partner may change the vaginal flora. The female partners of women with bacterial vaginosis should be examined and treated if the bacterial vaginosis is present. And we need not treat the male partners because they don't get the symptoms of this bacterial vaginosis and they don't transmit it. Screen and treat prior to the surgical abortion or hysterectomy. Though we need not treat the male partners, but any infection or pathology in the seminal fluid, it may affect the quality of the embryo formation. So we generally give as a routine a syndromic approach for treating both the couple before the start of the infertility treatment. So current treatment options for bacterial vaginosis are the antibiotics and antifungals. They remain the mainstay of the treatment, but the recurrence rate is high and they are associated with definitely the side effects. So here the role of probiotics come, and the probiotics which contain the lactobacillus, these are used over the longer period, unlike the antibiotics. And they can be sometimes alternative to the antibiotics in a long run, and particularly within the context of high infection recurrence rate. There is a possibility of harnessing the specific bacterial strains to prime the vaginal microbiota in the pre and periconceptual periods. So probiotics. So what is the definition of the probiotics? So according to the WHO, probiotics are defined as the live microorganisms, which when administered in adequate amounts, they confer a health benefit on the host. So to say they are a good potential probiotics, they should have these characteristics. They should be able to resist the action of acid or bile. They should be acid and bile stability, because they should go and act in the system of the GID, and they should adhere to the human intestinal cells. So they should be acid and bile stability, and they should be definitely from the human origin. They should also be produced, they should also able to produce the antimicrobial substances and adhere to the human intestinal cells. And they should be persistently present in the intestinal tract, and clinically validated and documented health effect they should produce. And they should have antagonistic effect on the enteric pathogens and susceptible to antibiotics, and they should be used safely in clinically. Coming to the prebiotics, they are the different entities. And these are the compounds which are present in the food, and they induce the growth and activity of the beneficial microorganisms. So in collection, the prebiotics and probiotics are combined called as synbiotics. Here the prebiotics should able to stimulate the growth and reproduction of only useful microflora, and they should improve the work of the digestive system. They should able to stimulate the peristalsis and suppress the reproduction of intestines of pathogenic bacteria, and they should be able to reduce the formation of gases, remove the excess mucus from the walls of the small intestine, and they should able to stimulate the local immunity. So vaginal probiotics rational to develop because it is very clearly hypothetically confirmed that there is a role of lactobacillus, and there is established a protective role of the lactobacillus, which are predominant in the vagina. And these vaginal probiotics can be applied topically, reaching high inocula, and there is no organoleptic considerations. And they are easy to perform even in the clinical trials. The sampling method is easy, and easy re-isolation of probiotic lactobacilli after application and already available. So definitely the vaginal probiotics have a role in avoiding the vaginal infections. They should able to develop a non-chemotherapeutic probiotic therapy using the lactobacilli to maintain the normal lactobacilli dominated vaginal flora, even in avoiding sexual transmitted disease, in preventing the preterm labor, and to improving the quality of the life of the women. And the ease of administration, it can be inserted directly into the vagina. Even there are oral preparations which can have its action from the gut to the vagina. And these are used in women who are prone to recurrent urogenital infections and during the infections also, but for not only infections, but for the healthy women to maintain the normal flora. In women who have the same thing we have computed in the previous slide. So here the probiotics versus antibiotics. The antibiotics, they normally damage the commensal microflora and they can increase the occurrence of resistant bacteria. And it can also have adverse side effects if they are used on a long-term basis and recurrent. Even resistance is more common. Probiotics can be used in adjunction with the antibiotics, and this helps in restoring the commensal microflora. So what is the ideal treatment? The ideal treatment should be able to provide the Indian genome specific strains, the vaginal specific strains, and the maximum colony forming unit should be 10 billion colony forming unit. So here, when we are treating the bacterial vaginosis condition and when we are not treating, in treated conditions, definitely the clinical pregnancy rate has increased to as high as 49%. Whereas when untreated or asymptomatic bacterial vaginosis infections, the clinical pregnancy rate dropped to 24%. So still the estrogen clinical trials are going on. There is a controlled trial of intravaginal estriol in postmenopausal women with recurrent urinary tract infections, and 93 postmenopausal women with a history of recurrent UTI when they have studied. There was a randomized double-blind placebo controlled trial of topical intravaginal estriol cream. And UTI incidence is 0.5 versus 5.9 episodes per patient per year. And here the lactobacilli restoration after 1 month, and vaginal pH is declined, maintaining it acidic pH, and vaginal enterobacteriaceae fell from 67, it has dropped from 67% to 31% with the estrogen supplementation, and it prevents a recurrent UTI in postmenopausal women. Probably this is by modifying the vaginal flora. So vaginal probiotics, the clinical trials are the treatment of bacterial vaginosis with the lactobacillus. 60 women with this infection, the double-blind placebo-controlled trial have made, and immediately after completion of the treatment, 16 out of 28 women treated with lactobacilli, they had normal vaginal wet smear results, and none of the 29 women treated with placebo. Only 3 of the women who received this lactobacillus suppository were free of this bacterial vaginosis after the subsequent menstruation. So these are various clinical trials, and coming to the probiotics versus the antibiotics. The antibiotics do damage the commensal microflora, so it should be used on a short course, not on a long term, and it will increase the occurrence of the resistant bacteria. Resistance is more common and they can have the side effects. But the good thing about the probiotics is that it can be used for a longer period and it is very safely used, and there is no resistant bacteria formed with the probiotics. But it can be used in adjunction to the antibiotics to restore the commensal microflora. So concluding my today's topic, an abnormal vaginal microbiota composition has been shown to lead to preterm births, miscarriage, and problems with conceiving. And studies have suggested that the dysbiosis reduces the successful early pregnancy development, procuring the IVF. Women with an abnormal vaginal microbiota are roughly 1.4 times less likely to have a successful early pregnancy development after IVF when compared to women with normal microbiota. Generally, we regularly treat the couple before starting of the fertility workup or treatment, and we give a syndromic approach to both the partners. So in conclusions, the treatment should be used carefully and cautiously and only on the basis of strong scientific evidence. If there is no infection, no treating. So response is species specific. The success of one species of lactobacillus in a certain application does not imply that all related strains of this species will be capable of producing a comparable response. So by this session, I want to end my topic.
Thank you very much, madam, for this nice and informative presentation. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, Suman, you are audible.
Okay. So, ma'am, please, ma'am, give me 1 minute for checking the questions.
Okay.
So, ma'am, the first question is, ma'am, is there any age-related factors for this kind of problem?
Yes, definitely. As I said, you the in age related, definitely age is related to the level of estrogen. In younger age group, the estrogen levels are very less, and this will decrease the population of the lactobacillus, and this will not produce the more number of adequate lactic acid and the acidic pH. So definitely, the extremes of age groups, they invite more infections. In the reproductive age group, or in the perimenopausal, or in the puberty stage, the estrogen levels are high, and these are directly linked with the population of the lactobacillus.
Okay, madam. And ma'am, what will be the approach if one patient comes with this kind of problem? Maybe she has some discharging problem. So what will be the approach to diagnose what exactly it is? Means what is the causative organism of this particular problem? So how do you diagnose that?
So the symptoms of the these gynec infections depends on the age. If the younger age group or children are coming with the similar infections, the treatment will be different. Or if the couple, if the infertility couple seeking the infertility treatment, if they come with these vaginal infections, the treatment will be different. So in these infertility age group, mostly the clinical examination or speculum examination of the vagina, it clearly shows the diagnosis of the bacterial vaginosis or other reproductive tract infections. So simply we can take the swab test for culture sensitivity, or we can give a syndromic approach. Suppose in the premenopausal, or suppose in the very early stages of puberty, and because of the less immunity, even the candida infections are more common. So the mere presence of thick, purulent cottage cheese appearance in the vagina, it clinches the diagnosis of candidiasis. Then we can treat the patient with the antifungals.
And madam, one question is, can prebiotic be used in vaginitis or vaginosis in children?
Yes, yes. Yeah, definitely prebiotic has a role in children who are suffering from recurrent vaginitis. But before treating that one, we have to rule out the what is the cause for this vaginitis in children. And mostly it may be because of the unhygienic, or because of the apprehension, or any stress-related factor, or because of the low immunity. So better to diagnose the cause of the vaginitis in children and then go with the proper antibiotics or antifungals. And prebiotics definitely play a role, as we use for any patient. Like in pediatric group, we give prebiotics for maintaining the flora in the GIT. So even the same thing will be helpful for the vaginal infections.
And madam, one thing, every prescription, that means every prescription should contain the probiotics apart from all the other drugs. What do you agree or not?
Yeah. Generally, as a clinician, I don't advise all the treatments. So if a patient presents with any clinical features, if the infection is there, then treat. Otherwise, no need of loading the prescriptions with all regular prebiotics. I don't prefer writing prebiotics on a regular basis. But definitely, if they have any history of the infections, or if to improve the quality of the life, yes, we can give the prebiotics over the certain period of time. And generally, in regular patients who are coming to me, the infertile couples, I give the prebiotics for a pre and probiotics over the period of 10 days every month, so that they will have a good coverage of this vaginal flora. And once they come out with the infertility treatment, then we can reduce the side effects of these less lactobacillus species.
And madam, how long does it take to exert its action towards the problem, means probiotics? So what is your practical observation on that? How much time it's need to...
There are no particular studies which show about the duration or the onset of the action, but yes, over the period of 10 to 20 days, if the body is loaded with prebiotics, definitely it will show in the vaginal flora or vaginal epithelium secretions. So it will take around 1 month to 2 months.
And ma'am, do you have what is your practical observation in terms of socio-economic condition of the patient with this problem?
Pardon, please get that.
Is there any relation between the socio-economic status of the patient and bacterial vaginosis or other this type of disease?
Yes, definitely there is a role of socio-economic status. Generally, in lower socio-economic status, when they don't follow the menstrual hygiene properly, when the washing techniques are improper, then there are the risk of vaginal infections. Even in a higher social economic group also, where nowadays the career-oriented women and the lifestyle modification or dress style, wearing the tight jeans, so it will lock the vaginal moisture and it will imbibe a lot of pathogenic organisms to form. And this will cause the recurrent vaginal infections.
Okay, madam, I could not get another question. So, if you allow me, then we can wind up the session for today's event.
Yeah, any more questions to be answered?
No, ma'am, it's over. Means all the questions we have already discussed, ma'am. If again we can find some question, we will get back to you, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, Suman, thank you so much. And thank you for all the audience for your patient hearing. For me, this topic, though it is a very dry topic, I just want to tell that this definitely has a role in infertility seeking couple, and sometimes frequent infections are definitely distressing to the females. And thank you so much for all the team members in the Shield and for giving me this opportunity to share this topic.
And thank you very much, madam, once again for your valuable time in our platform. And in future also, we look forward for some interesting topic from your end. And also, I can see many appreciation for this presentation in our platform. So thank you very much, ma'am, and good day, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor, for the participation. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you very much, ma'am.